Hello, everyone. Welcome back and welcome to the last day of the school. So here today, it is my pleasure to introduce Pedro Saleiro. So Pedro is currently director of research at FIDSAI. So there he leads a group on fairness, accountability, transparency, and ethics. Pedro has a PhD from the University of Porto. Previously, he was also postdoc at the University of Chicago and a research scientist at the Center for Data Science and Public Policy. So there he worked on data science for social good projects with government and nonprofit institutions. So Pedro has extensive work on interpretability, responsible AI. So he has published on those areas. He has served the community on these, for instance, through the organization of workshops and tutorials. And well, his practical talk here today is also on fairness in machine learning. So Pedro, whenever you are ready, I guess the Zoom connection is yours.
Well, thank you so much for the introduction. First of all, it's really, really a pleasure to be here. And you know, on the last day of the summer school, we will have kind of a relaxed talk, but about a kind of a serious subject. And this is really an introductory practical talk because usually we feel that there are lots of content available online for about methods. At the end of the talk, I'll share some resources about the main conferences in this area. But what I really want to share with you today is a way of thinking about these issues and how to tackle in practice when developing solutions based on machine learning that will affect people's lives somehow. So this is a shorter version of our AAAI 21 tutorial with Ray Dagani and Kit Rodolfo. I'll make the slides available afterwards so you can also access to the fairness tutorial page with interactive collab notebooks that run and you can try and audit real models by yourself. But I want to start with a kind of a illustrative example as a motivation. So let's assume that there is a virus, the virus X, there is an outbreak and there is high mortality rate on people with certain medical conditions. And it's not really obvious to identify these people that are more at risk. At the same time, a new drug that is effective was developed, but is very, very expensive. So we cannot just give the drug to the whole population. And the CDC decides to create a machine learning model using electronic health records, using social media data to predict people at risk so it can prioritize who must get this treatment. And here we have an initial display on two groups of the population, black versus white. And what we can see is that the mortality rate is actually very different for these two groups. It's way higher for black than compared to white. And the machine learning model that was trained for this intervention use the standard machine learning pipeline that optimize for global recall. So by optimizing by global recall, we are basically trying to get as most at-risk people as possible with machine learning model. In fact, when breaking down recall for different groups in this model, in a test set, it was verified that there were some disparities in recall, meaning that in this specific case, it was a much higher recall for white. And what happens if we deploy this model and we start using this model to prioritize people, to give intervention, this new drug, with the goal of reducing the mortality rate of the virus X? What we actually see is that there is a widening gap and the disparities are getting larger over time. Because we are, you know, much more effective on detecting people at risk from the white group than from the black group, what happens in practice is that the mortality rate, and of course this is assuming that there is no heterogeneous treatment effects and the treatment is effective, but what we can see is that the mortality rate is going down a much higher rate for white than for black. And this is creating these disparities and these you know, discriminatory intervention in the society over time. What happens if we optimize for fairness? Optimizing for fairness in this context would be that we somehow, with a fairness intervention, and we will discuss briefly how can we get that, if we equalize recall for both groups, what happens over time is that the gap stays the same, but both groups decrease the mortality rate at the same rate. And some may question, okay, this is fair. The intervention is being applied at the same rates across groups, but there is still a gap between these two groups. And if we think about using these kind of a continuously over time, there will be a time in which the virus is just deadly for one group of population while the other is already all treated with the drug. And another option would be to optimize for equity. And optimizing for equity here is really about converging these two mortality rates. So instead of widening or keeping the gap, is really about reducing the gap. Of course, in practice, these results in some sacrifices in terms of global recall and global utility. But what we are seeing here is in terms of equity, the mortality rate of the virus becomes the same across two groups. And this is just a very illustrative example, just to create this kind of a setting on thinking what is the impact on the problems we want to tackle with machine learning, on the interventions we want to be using that are informed by machine learning. And when we are developing machine learning models, to create this awareness of the long-term effects of the decisions we make while building the machine learning models and selecting and deploying, we'll have later on in the target population based on this intervention. And now moving on trying to describe a little bit what is our framework of thoughts about this topic, and moving on a little bit about discussing some of the sources of bias, but starting with kind of a framework of thought here. So it's really about, you know, our policies and systems we build, they need to reflect our values. And usually we tend to define our objective function, we optimize for that metric, and we are happy with results, and we report incremental gains on those metrics, and our job is done. But in fact, here what the community and the society at large has been kind of starting to discuss in these last 5 years or so, since around 2016 with the ProPublica article about the COMPASS algorithm, is that we need to make sure it's not just enough to build effective systems based on machine learning. We really need to be sure that these systems reflect our own ethical values when being used and impacting people over time. So the million-dollar question here is really, how do we develop these systems to help make decisions that will lead to fair and equitable outcomes? And the first thing that is really relevant to note here is that it's not just really enough to just optimize for fairness in the model. So once again, we have this bias for action in terms of community in machine learning. And what we've seen in initial papers and works on this area is that, you know, we tend to jump in to define a specific fairness metric, and we also try to apply our you know, tools and techniques to optimize for that, you know, second objective. But in practice, that is not really enough, because often what happens is that the machine learning model is not making decisions by itself. It's part of a larger decision-making system. So it's not really enough to make just machine learning model fair. The actions that are being taken based on the predictions of the model then reflect on outcomes, and we should measure fairness on the outcomes, because that's where we can really measure impact. And here, this is a very subjective way of thinking about this. Other people think that what is really important is that if we build a machine learning model that is fair, and you know, our job is done, and it's other responsibility to use it wisely. But in fact, what really is important in our perspective is how these systems are, you know, interacting and impacting the society in terms of outcomes. In our illustrative example, was really about the mortality rate of virus X. And also, we don't want to you know, fall in a trap of not using or not deploying the interventions just because they are not perfect. And here, perfect with respect of utility and fairness or equity. So it's really, really important that we think first of what would be the baseline, what are the current status quo, and before making a decision about deploying or not deploying the machine learning model, to have some sort of comparison. It can even be a human decision maker. So we can think about, you know, having doctors making some sort of triage or assessing risk or some specific guidelines, and comparing the fairness results with these between the machine learning model and the baseline or the current intervention. And there is also a common rush or misconception about assuming that bias is just reflected in the data. In practice, we, as machine learning practitioners, we are making small interventions ourselves, making small decisions as we are building our pipelines and deploying our systems. We are making these small decisions, and all of these decisions will affect somehow the end fairness that we get in terms of outcomes and impact. One obvious example, and we see many examples with respect of, you know, language models, computer vision. Most often the case is that we have a problem of sample bias. So we don't have enough representation for specific groups or subgroups of the population, or for specific cases as gender, or for specific types of images with respect, for instance, on skin color, on training data sets. And this is often the most common example of sources of bias. And there is also one other aspect that is often disregarded, which is the label bias. Because in practice, when we are defining these interventions, we come up with a definition of what is a one, or what is a zero, what is a positive example and negative example. And often because we are modeling a proxy variable for what we really want to optimize for, because you know we might not be able to optimize for mortality rate. We will optimize for detecting people at risk or not, we'll define what would be those medical conditions in the example I mentioned before. And this is often arbitrarily defined by stakeholders that quantify what is a one or what is a zero. There is this human intervention here, and we might have different level quality with respect to different groups of the population. And this is very the case with, for instance, I work in projects with the internal police investigations in US, and often what happens is that there are many files, many complaints, but just a few consequential kind of consubstantiated disciplinary actions, because there is some internal committee that might be biased or not. And then if we use those labels as our training or target function, we'll introduce some sort of disparity down the line. And all the decisions we make regarding imputation, the way we understand and explore the data, the hyperparameter search space we use, the metric we are trying to optimize and for select models, all these decisions that we make in the machine learning pipeline will introduce some sort of bias. A very common example is record linkage, where we have some sort of unstructured data and we want to link different records that are related with the same entity. And this is often not a completely perfect linkage. And what happens when we do that is we might end up with duplicates. And these will introduce actually bias in terms of the feature distributions over groups and the prevalence over groups that will have really downstream effects here. But also it's not just in the data, the humans or the actions that are informed with the predictions of the machine learning model might not have the same impact on different groups of the population. And it might even happen that the machine learning model that is very fair when being coupled with a human expert that is in the loop, that has some unconscious bias or you know specific experience that do not completely trust the machine learning model prediction, might have some systematic overrides against specific groups of the population. And then in this kind of hybrid human AI system, usually the human, and thankfully the human has the last call, but it might happen that we have some sort of bias intervention, the discriminatory overrides. Also, the actions that are being taken based on the prediction of the machine learning model might have heterogeneity with different groups. Think about, you know, reaching out to people in English or in Portuguese and immigrants that don't really speak the language might not be open for, you know, that intervention, and therefore they will miss opportunity. Although the model made the right prediction, the intervention didn't work out for specific groups of the population. So always thinking about how the model is going to be used in practice and how different groups. And often what we do is we are just able to measure these effects really using randomized controlled trials on the interactions. And an example that we usually use on the tutorial is this typical disaster relief. There is broad work on using social media when there is some disaster, hurricanes, earthquakes, and so on, to try to reach out to people that really in areas that are really affected. And if we think about the data that we have access to, it would be Twitter posts, social media posts, and basically, what are the risks of potential source of bias that we have here? Well, first, the population that use Twitter might not be representative of a specific geographic area. Then people, for instance, there is a bias to share in this situation negative things much more, and there is a tendency to amplify negative effects of these kind of disasters, and may become really difficult to evaluate the degree of severity of these disasters. And if we think about specific more remote areas, older population that does not use Twitter and so on. So this is an example in which our sample might really not be representative of the target population affected here. And the analysis and the actions need to take into account these potential effects here. So how can we really measure or define fairness? There are many, many definitions. Actually, the community in the beginning, when it started tackling these issues, the community really rushed into defining what is fair, so others can come up with methods to optimize for those metrics. And one metric that is often very used is this concept of demographic parity, which defines that the probability of a classifier predicting a given instance as positive is independent from the group. And this definition is really, really limited in practice. Because this definition really does not take into account the prevalence or the actual target label that we wanted to train our ML models in the first place. It may be the case that in certain applications in which we don't get access to the label at inference time, not at that point or even later, having some sort of equal probability of predicting as positive across the class may be suitable, but in most cases, there are different prevalences across these two or three or any subgroups of the population. And we are more interested in defining fairness with respect to errors of the model. And basically, any metric derived from the confusion matrix can be used to compare disparities across different groups. Usually, the most common way of comparing is to ratios. Some people use differences. They have pros and cons. And both way of comparing groups, usually we are talking about false positive rates and true positive rates as the most common metrics that we want to equalize for both groups. But I have here some examples. But first, I want to highlight a trade-off that was kind of shown in 2017. Actually, almost at the same time, both Kleinberg and Scholtzova, they kind of, with a few weeks difference, they published works that highlighted these incompatibilities between metrics derived from the coefficient matrix. So, basically, what we have here is that We can formulate the false positive rate as depending on the prevalence and the precision and the true positive rate. And what are the implications of this formulation? Is that when we want to compare two groups, we'll have two different confusion matrices, one for each group, and two different prevalences, one for each group. And if we think about ratios, and ratios are very common ways of comparing disparities. So we divide false positive rate of group A with false positive rate of group B. What we get in practice is that if the prevalence is not the same for the two groups, then we cannot achieve equal false positive rate, precision, and true positive rate at the same time. We have to sacrifice one of those. We cannot really have complete parity across these metrics if we have different prevalences among these two groups. And actually, in the illustrative example that I've shown, the mortality rate for the black group was higher than for the white group. So in that case, regardless of having a human making decision, having one machine learning model, having two machine learning models, having whatever kind of complex decision-making process here, we will never be able to equalize all of these metrics because the prevalence is different. And you can, I invite you to try these, afterwards, really, you come up with, two different confusion matrices and the prevalence is different. So the positive rate is different on the two confusion matrices, and you'll never be able to equalize false positive rate, precision, and true positive rate for any threshold for any confusion metrics. And some people have been using this incompatibility as kind of an excuse, saying, and now I'm really being somehow biased. Often we can think about more executive people claiming that, even the machine learning community, they realize that it's not possible to achieve absolute fairness on all error metrics. So what should we do? And in practice, what we have seen by the experience, especially in the Center for Data Science and Public Policy, when building these tailored interventions for specific projects, is that specific use cases will be more concerned about specific fairness metrics. Or in other words, there are some of these error metrics that I've shown before that are more suitable for specific interventions than others in use cases. So going on an example of a punitive action example, and this is really the way we frame it, is really to think about who gets affected by the action, by the intervention, and if the action is punitive or assistive. Are we hurting people that we predict as positive, or are we providing some sort of benefit to the people that we predict as positive? And here another illustrative example of a model being used to make bail determinations, which is very common in US. This kind of was the trigger for this new interest and awareness on tackling issues of bias and fairness in machine learning model was really this article from the ProPublica magazine from 2016, in which they audited predictions for bail determination of the COMPASS algorithm across different states in the US, and they realized that the risk was really not well distributed across groups of population. And specifically, they found that the false positive rate for African Americans was twice as the false positive rate of the Caucasian people. And this in practice meant that people predicted a higher risk if they were African Americans. They were two times more likely to actually not be high risk than the Caucasian individuals. And different people might consider it fair in different of these error rates or definitions that I've shown before. And in fact, there is no universally accepted definition of what is fair. And this is an example that some people might consider a fair decision-making system as a system that has actually equal absolute numbers, equal counts of false positives across the groups. Of course, this does not take into consideration the size of these different groups. Another one is now adjusted by the group size. So the error rates across groups should be the same. Another definition is now conditioned on the predictions, on the decisions of models or the system. And for the people that are predicted as positive and they are a false positive, the rates should be equal across groups. So one minus precision should be the same, or you can even think about precision. So the precision parity between groups should be the same. Although this definition has some problems because of the actual prevalence across different groups, and false positive rate actually accounts for that, because now it's conditioned on the label. So based on merit or risk, depending on if it's a punitive or assistive setting, here we are conditioning on the label. So the probability of having a false positive if you are innocent is independent of the group. And there are mirror definitions for label positives, so equalizing recall, equalizing precision, equalizing false omission rate. And basically what we came up by this practice on different projects is that stakeholders had really a hard time choosing which of these metrics made more sense for each project and for each case. So we try to come up with this kind of framework to help different stakeholders to come up with, or narrowing down the menu of options, because we already know that if the prevalences are different, and often they are, and they are different because of many different socioeconomic causes, we are trying to kind of help in navigating these metrics because of the compatibility of having all of them at the same time. So we are really focusing here, and this is the main point, is if the intervention is punitive or if the intervention is assistive for the people that are affected by the intervention. And basically, this is as simple as if it's punitive, we care more about false positives. So all the rates that have had to do with false positives. If it's assistive, we care about all the metrics related with label positives. So recall parity, false negative rate, false omission rate, and so on. There is one nuance here, and this is really tailored for public policy, is because in data science for social good projects, what happens in practice is that we have a resource allocation problem. So we want to help solve a specific social problem in a specific area. It can be healthcare or criminal justice, but we have limited resources. So we are using machine learning to really inform these interventions and to become really, really efficient on these projects. So because we have very limited budget for positive interventions, what happens in practice is that we are helping just a small fraction of the population that really need help. And in that aspect, we really forced to be recalled because we are thinking about ratios, and the false negative rate will be almost like 99% for all groups. So the ratios will seem very fair if we think about false negative rates. But if we think about recall, basically, we might be comparing 1% recall in one group with 0.1% recall in other groups. And if we compare in that way, it's like 10 times the disparity for two groups. And this is just the only remark here. And if is it 3D answer? No, but it's really, as I mentioned before, a really starting point to have a conversation to really narrowing down the metrics. Ultimately, the definition and choice of which metric should be optimized for should be decided by the relevant stakeholders. And also another thing that I want to highlight is that what really changes with machine learning and fairness, decision making has been around for many years. What is different now? What is really different is that because we are being explicit as we want to optimize for specific metrics, we need to be explicit about what is our definition of fairness. And organizations and companies, public authorities need really to define what means fair for each specific domain of our society. And this is the hard conversation that I think we are now all starting to have, because by using these systems, we need to be explicit about what we are optimizing for. And also, if we are explicit, we are accountable later on to see the impacts on the population. And now it's really, all-time cliche of Lord Kelvin, if you don't measure, you can't improve it. So the first step is really to, stop just evaluating global error rates and also breaking down by specific groups to, have a notion of how the model behaves in different groups of the population. And back in 2017, when I started my postdoc, there were actually no open source libraries available for quickly adding to the pipeline this kind of breakdown analysis. And we developed an open source library, Aikitas, that is really focused for more for public policy, social good, interventions in terms of decision making. Kind of applications, but fortunately since then there have been other libraries that have been proposed as well. And what do we need to predict to use to audit models predictions? We need the actual predictions, we need the attributes that define the protected groups, and this is also challenging because sometimes we just have proxy variables for the groups. And this is often the excuse of stakeholders to not audit for bias and fairness, or to not measure because, we don't have these data. And this becomes kind of a self-fulfilling prophecy in the sense that we don't have these data, so we don't know if we are fair, but because we don't have these data, we probably are fair. So let's not collect this data. And this goes on. And, now, kind of a side note, the EU regulation that has been proposed, there is a bill out there to for public consulting. Sometimes there is this paradox in this kind of regulation with respect to these kind of demographic sensitive information, because there is this tension between not collecting this data and being fair at the same time. So even if by legal reasons or even ethical reasons, it's not correct to use this particular information in the modeling process, it needs to be used to audit. Otherwise, we will keep in the dark here. There is also often this misconception of if we should or not use this type of data. As you realize by this talk being more practical, we tend to have a very empirical approach to this question. It's really about, you know, we may or not use, it's just one of the options that we run to test for which model optimized for the metrics. So sometimes, especially for instance in healthcare, knowing the gender or sex or knowing some ethnic information is really correlated with the label or the risk of specific diseases, and is actually might help in the overall utility of the system. So it's not really, you know, kind of a binary decision here, is really to try and see, but always use those attributes for the audits. And there is also the need for having labels to actually have a real notion of these disparities in error rates. And this is also something that sometimes is difficult, because if we are doing selective decisions, we often don't have the counterfactual. So what happens is that we, for instance, in bail determination, if we decide to keep someone in jail because there is a risk of this person would recidivate or escape from trial, if we keep them in jail, we actually never know if they would really escape if they were set free. So in these situations, it becomes a little bit more tricky to assess the errors. And this is just an example, and I probably should move forward here, but this is an example of visualizations we have with Equitas. And basically, is an easy way to compare these ratios. In this case, the radius is the size of the group, and the central dot is actual disparity compared to the reference group. And there are different ways of selecting what would be the reference group. Reference group basically is the denominator of the ratio of the metrics. And this is a very easy way to visualize and really go deep on specific model and understand and how it is performing for different subgroups of the population. This is one of the examples that we have in the furnace tutorial that I invite you to see later. But as I mentioned before, fortunately, there are already other open source packages available for ML practitioners to, you know, bring fairness into their standard practice. One of these examples is Fairlearn from Microsoft. Actually, Microsoft is this responsible AI toolkit. So not just Fairlearn. Fairlearn is one of the packages targeting just fairness, but they are on model interpretability, error analysis, and other packages they have under this responsible AI toolkit. But in specific, Fairlearn, what offers is that besides comparing error rates across different groups as well, it also offers fairness enhancing methods. And in specific, three types of methods, in processing, post-processing, pre-processing. In this domain, someone came up with this taxonomy, but basically in pre-processing means that you are changing the representation before fitting the model. In processing basically means that you are optimizing for fairness as well, either through a regularizer term, constraint optimization, that's you are feeding the model with fairness as objective or constraint. And post-processing is about different thresholding or calibrations for different groups of the population. So you train the model, and then after you somehow transform the predictions to be adjusted by different traits across groups. And this library offers this exponential weighted reduction. Is a method also from Microsoft from 2018 that is rather slow and has some limitations, but in this talk I'm not going really further there. I really invite you to try it yourself. Post-processing is the most common one, is a paper from Moritz Hart 2016 about equality of opportunity in supervised learning. It's kind of a seminal work on this area. And pre-processing has to do with somehow changing the data before we fit the model in a way that we remove some correlations between specific group information and the target label. IBM also has this AI Fairness 360 that offers some pre-processing methods, although it's kind of not so well maintained as the Fairland package. Some of these methods are not really proved to be effective, but also has the threshold calibration and another method called meta classifier. So what is our workflow in practice? We build models. We can build models wherever we decide to build, and we should always audit for bias and fairness. If there is an issue, we need to apply some sort of bias mitigation, and then we are ready to use this model in practice. Also, I think, you know, for this audience today, this is quite obvious, but I still find this question a lot of, you know, why we don't just simply remove the sensitive information from the data set. And then if the model doesn't know the attribute, how can it be discriminatory? Actually, in practice, as you all know, and it's very easy to predict these sensitive attributes by, you know, analyzing behavior, analyzing other signals. It's very easy to predict gender and income from Instagram likes or from Facebook posts. So it's not really just enough to just remove the specific categories from the models. And often we still see, although the media is making a really terrific job with respect to signaling and talking about specific cases of discrimination, they still accept this type of justifications from executives, that this fairness blind kind of paradigm of not collecting information. So how can we be unfair if we don't know if people are white or any other ethnic group? Regarding families of bias mitigation methods, I need to say that this is kind of an invitation for you as a community. There is still no really, really breakthrough. There is no method that people come to realize that, well, every time we always should use this as baseline, at least. No, we don't have that kind of breakthrough. In practice, the method that has been more robust and consistent across different applications has been the thresholding. So really finding different thresholds for equalizing different error rates. For basically what it means that in the ROC curve, we have different ROC curves for different groups, and we find and we equalize and we fix like 5% false positive rate or 50% recall, and we use those different thresholds for different groups at different time. And that is 100% fair in the validation data set, but then it's more prone to variance if it happens in practice. this really depends on the application. So we have pre-processing, processing, post-processing algorithms. Some kind of overview here. So the idea of pre-processing, as I mentioned before, is to learn a representation that is independent from the group while still keeping relevant information that is able to predict the label. In processing, is really to change the learning process. Disadvantage is very model and metric specific. There are methods that work for rates, other metrics just work for differences. Some metrics just work for predictions, condition on the label, other ones don't work for condition on the prediction. So precision, for instance, precision rates are not suitable for these methods. Post-processing, the really, really disadvantage is that you really have to have access to group information at inference time. So because you have different thresholds for different groups, you need to know when making predictions the group that the instance belongs to. So these learn fair representations, there are many, many, many papers, these fair variation autoencoders, fair GANs. So usually this is the way. Basically what you really want is to run this X representation that is not correlated with Z, but still has information about B, Y given X. TensorFlow constraint optimization is also one popular method. The other one being the Fairlearn one in processing that are available in Fairlearn, the one with the reductions. This one is a more vanilla constraint optimization approach for neural networks. Actually, it can be used for any other constraint, data-dependent constraints, and it's specific for rates. So we define specific rates on different attributes of the data. And because typically rates of TPR, rates of FPR are not really differentiable because we have an indicator function, because all of these metrics are based on confusion matrix. Basically the trick that this method does is that it uses proxy constraints using the inch or the sigmoid. And then basically uses that for the descent step and for the ascent step, actually for the Lagrangians, uses the actual rates. Basically what you get at the end is that the score no longer represents the probability of Y given X, or now is a different concept what you get as a score because as this notion and constraints of X. Threshold calibration, as I said, is as simple as equalizing different metrics. I think it's really, really, if you have an option to deploy different thresholds for different groups, I think it's a good practice. If you can, if you have access to this information at inference time, I really would make it standard to have specific thresholds. Another thing is that actually we notice at FeedsEye is that when we try to, you know, analyze performance versus fairness for many, many models, and this is basically, imagine a huge random search of model hyperparameters and different algorithms. And by hyperparameters, I mean every decision on the machine learning pipeline. It's not just hyperparameters of the learning algorithm, but different groups of features, different pre-processing, different imputation, different samples, and so on, and see how these results in performance and fairness on an all-out data set, like the validation data set. Actually, what we see is that on regions that are fairness blind, so just optimizing for the performance metric, which is the standard practice, we can see that there is a wide spread of fairness metric for the same region of the performance, of the predictive accuracy. In this case, in the example, it's precision, but we have seen that for recall or for other metrics. And this is actually true on different slices in different regions of the predictive performance. So we were wondering, how can we target more regions that are more interesting in the Pareto line between performance and fairness. And basically we came up with this very simple intervention, which is, so we have all these possible intervention, all these possible hyperparameters. We have all these different things we can try in terms of pre-processing, processing methods. How can we decide which is the best for a specific application? So we realized that there was no fairness-aware hyperparameter optimization. So we basically came up with this framework of when performing the search on hyperparameters to account for the two goals in terms of accuracy and fairness. And basically, what we are talking here is traditional MOO approach in which we basically use scalarization for both fairness and performance. And what we have found in practice is that, is it possible to target this point B here if we give enough weight to the fairness metric? And actually we came up with some heuristics to automatically find this elbow region here on the Pareto. And actually we observe in empirically that this Pareto line tends to be convex in practice. So we came up with some heuristics to find this optimal alpha for balancing and scaling weights for performance and fairness. And this way, when we are doing hyperparameter optimization, we automatically target those regions. So a wrap up, it's not just the model, it's the model, the actions and the outcomes. It's not just enough to think about the fairness of the model. We need to see how this intervention will affect people down the line. Then it's really about bringing in these goals on every stage of the projects, even initially from scoping, defining what are our goals, what we want to achieve, what type of data do we have, what are the risks of the data, how is the data distributed. But if we have throughout this traditional standard procedure on training machine learning models, if we have in mind always this bigger picture with respect to fairness and goals, we'll have much more room to make informed decisions on the way. Also, not all the fairness metrics are indicated for specific applications. Fairness tree is just a way of trying to narrow down the options. Always audit the fairness of the models and report it. And if possible, make it public, foster transparency on this decision-making process. And also think about comparison to current baselines. And now more generic kind of useful practice. And you know, it's this is not just blah, blah, blah. It's really about creating this awareness on different stakeholders. You know, we at the university, throughout our work life, it's not always given that we'll have training with respect to ethics and impact. So I really invite you to, you know, to read more about it, to you know, learn from other areas that are really experts in this. Particularly, I found that although philosophy and legal are good sources, in practice, I think public policy literature is really where there is this balance between theory, conceptualization, and practice, and solving hard problems in practice. And I really recommend to go to public policy to understand more about this. And some resources, we have a book chapter on the new edition of Big Data and Social Science book. Here is the link that is open online, and it's a very friendly, easy to read introductory chapter about mostly about metrics and how to measure it. Also, there's lots of resources from Raed Ghani group on data science public policy on how to scope, on to define when building these projects and starting these projects and how to bring fairness to all these stages. Also, once again, you have the tutorial, and I invite you to, there is a longer YouTube video, there is Collab notebooks, and there is also other pointers for other resources. Canada, a couple of years ago, was really progressive, and it has been very progressive with respect to responsible AI. And also you have Montreal AI. They have actually a newsletter about responsible AI that I also recommend. And they came up with this kind of questionnaire to assess the impact of different interventions, different systems. Other seminal work from model cards, work from Team Nick Gebru, these data sets cards as well. It's a good way of forcing us to go over all these different aspects of what we are building and not just train, test, performance. Also, the FACT conference is becoming really competitive and a very interesting conference that has a particularity of having computer science tracks, but also legal and philosophy or more ethics tracks. There is this online book from Salon Barakos and Moritz Hart that is also publicly available. Some courses from some universities that I will also make available as pointers. Now on the books, I was mentioning about public policy. I really recommend, if I had to pick one, I would pick the Policy Paradox. Definitely recommend you. If you want to think about impact, decisions, and difficult trade-offs and tensions, Policy Paradox is really, really good reference. And I think that's it from my side.
So, okay, thanks, Pedro. So we have a couple of questions in the Q&A, and there's also, I think it was the first one question in the chat window. So do you want to take a look, Pedro? Do you prefer for us to give you the questions?
Either way, I'd say.
So I would suggest then for you to take a look at the Q&A and go through the questions there.
So shall I start with Q&A or chat?
Q&A, I would say.
Okay. All right. So do you think it could be possible to identify subtler biases within a model by bootstrapping from well-defined ones? Not sure if I really understood completely the question. I would imagine that here, what we are talking about is if we have an example in the same domain, same type of data, if an example of a bias model, we with a bias data set, we might want to use it as a bootstrap. I'm not sure if I really follow this question. Okay, maybe if someone would like to rephrase it and I can give it a try. Maybe I go to the second one. In the initial example you gave, it is not necessarily clear to me why sacrificing global mortality in order to boost is ethical justified. Oh, that's a very interesting point here. Well, I didn't make a consideration about what would be the right way moving forward. I presented three different options that often are not taken into account when deciding which of the machine learning models should go into production. And once again, in public policy, there is this question, and this type of question is really a kind of a root question that has been around for a long time. Can we sacrifice utility to promote fairness and equity? That kind of sometimes trade-off or tension has been around for a long time. Here, for me, as not being an expert in ethics, I can only give my subjective opinion, but what I think it's becoming kind of perceived as a good practice is to not have unilateral decisions of what which ones of the possible options should be used in practice, but having committees and steering committees and ethical boards that will make a decision of which one of the different trade-offs makes more sense in specific cases, because there might have some secondary effects that my illustration was not really depicting. I was really just trying to kind of tease your brain on thinking that often when we just optimize for one metric, we don't really realize of the other effects down the road. And really also part of the community and the subjects that are affected by decisions should also be taken into consideration. And the problem with the Compass example is that it was an unilateral decision from the company that decided what fair meant in that case. And I think we need to move away from that. And we as, usually we tend to have a self-perception as being very smart because we work in a technical area, but there are other people that have also tools to make these informed decisions. And let me move on to second one. To what extent do you think collaboration with representatives from this community that let me just see if I don't think collaboration with the representatives from this community groups could guide bias reduction. Do you feel developers ever reach out to people who are members of this community groups and involved in? Yes, definitely. I think it's really throughout organizations. So In companies, often we have, you know, product managers, we have product owners, we have program managers, we have project managers, we have software engineers, ML engineers, data scientists. And it's not up just to the data scientists to make these calls. We have a shared responsibility to, because we have access to data and we use the data, we have a shared responsibility to flag and create awareness of different trade-offs and limitations that may exist in the data. And definitely, I definitely think that we should involve people affected, not just discriminated, but also the group of affected people, because often the perception of what is a priority is very different. So definitely, I think involving people makes doesn't the incorporability of metrics suggest that these metrics may be unfit to measure fairness in AI? Shouldn't we try to come up with new metrics and new concepts accordingly? That's a good point. Definitely, I think we should come up with the new metrics, new from different areas as well. The thing with error rates is that what happens is in practice is that if you are, for instance, providing a benefit, what really happens with a false positive? What is the cost of a false positive for the people being affected? So if you are providing a benefit for someone that really doesn't need, it's more an opportunity cost than a cost to the affected person. So whatever metric we come up with, it should take into account what is the cost of an error somehow for different groups of a population. And we have been working in cases in fact that it happens that different groups have different costs, in the sense that, for instance, we once worked with a project on detecting people child abuse, and the intervention was monitoring and following families, and the intervention was considered punitive for the parents because they were considered risk and they were being really thoroughly analyzed, but they were the intervention was also considered assistive for the child that are at risk, for the children at risk. So then it becomes tricky to not optimize for all the metrics at the same time. So definitely More metrics make sense, absolutely. Do you think it could be, this is some question, do you think that given the current set of ML, generally no accuracy is close to 100%, many models are not really interpretable, models are not held accountable for their decisions, many risk actions simply should not be handled over to ML systems? Well, I must say that humans are very, very bad at predicting the future. So humans are far from being perfect decision makers. So I'd say that the overarching goal is to have a system in which the ML model plus humans work better, are more efficient and more fair in working together than just a human or just ML model. And also there are other situations in which it's not even feasible to have humans making all decisions. Think about digital payments and my particular domain of work of interest nowadays, about the predicting fraud, or predicting access to bank accounts. We're talking about millions of transactions that happen every hour, and it's not really feasible to have only a human making decisions. But having the human inspecting some of the decisions, having the human creating some signal that is kept over time, even the error reinforcement learning and counterfactuals and even in these cooperative systems is really a hot topic nowadays, and I think it makes totally sense to do that. But in really risky areas, I don't believe that we should only rely on machine learning model to make decisions. We always need a human oversight in specific, particularly cases as punitive settings with the judge. But I think the model and the judge can make better decisions than just the judge. Could you spend some words on what is current status and what are the future perspectives of artificial inference assessments? Which industry sectors are leading the way in the implementation of fairness assessment precision ML pipelines? Well, all the human resources industry has been kind of on the spot with respect to fairness in recruiting and automatic CV screening tools. Healthcare, absolutely. Even recently, there was an example of an algorithm that was over-optimistic for Black patients. And what happens by being over-optimistic for Black patients was that these patients at risk, they were not being selected for kidney transplants as often as the same risk patients from other racial groups. So healthcare, absolutely. Finance as well. Finance is a highly regulated domain, and there are some key players that are moving the needle here. With respect of publications and media cover, everything related with large language models is becoming really, really hot. The question of bias, and I believe you are aware of that, and That's somehow tricky because it's more about learning a fair representation without having in mind a specific decision or intervention. And I still believe that even if we come up with a definition of a fair representation of a language model, with respect to gender, for instance, we still need to assess if we are using that language model to create a decision-making system that will make decisions based on representations from the language model. We still need to measure and account for these procedures I just mentioned about auditing down the line. I have some general topics on which I would like to hear your opinion. Are we familiar with new regulation? Do you have any opinion on how good this new regulation, second fairness, this new regulation does not include research? Do you think fairness should also be taken into account during research, although there are still no actions taken against and therefore probably no impact on real people? What kind of mechanism would allow more fair research while not constraining it, for example, relational impact and versus making very respectful? Yes, I'm familiar with the new UA regulation. It's based on risk. So it's becoming more and more clear that in companies and public organizations, when building systems based on AI, we will start to have risk analysis as procedure, current procedure on before deploying an ML model. And risk here is usually quantified by severity and probability of occurrence. And then you is proposing some specific domains and applications as high risk. And if this application is considered high risk, there is a specific more thorough procedures with respect to audits, to interpretability, to reporting, to governance, to accountability. And even with external bodies, like some regulatory authority, if it's deemed low risk, then the regulation is not really pushing and moving the needle if it's considered low risk. There is advantage and disadvantage in this approach. So because basically what they are doing is that everything that is about facial recognition, everything that is about policing, everything that is about hiring, access to state benefits, visa applications for entering or working in a country, these are considered really high risk applications in criminal justice. But this really is restricting the notion that, oh, if we are working in a non-risk application, we don't need to care about threats. And that has some risk on life. Regarding research, there is this concept of regulatory sandboxes. And I think we also need to come up with these kind of sandboxes for research as well. So basically what that means is that because we need to start having this kind of a co-creation of regulation, we want to inform regulators on what the policy should be updated on. And for that, we should have sandboxes. And in sandboxes, research is really fundamental in the sense that we should try control experiments, of course, following ethical frameworks, in which we can test different things in practice. So definitely, I think universities and research organizations have a really key role here. I know that private companies, research groups are also trying to play a role there as well. I think it's completely relevant and makes sense, and the industry is pushing that forward as well. But I also think universities have a special role here and should definitely work more on these kind of having more randomized controlled trials with machine learning models and this kind of assessing this type of aspects. In the fairness assessment workflow, we start with model building. Does it mean that the evaluation of bias in data collection data generation is considered as falling outside the domain of? Well, that's a good point. You can always quantify bias in the data somehow. There is some, feature conditioning, distributions, and KL divergence or other divergence metrics on distributions condition on the labels and on the groups. Although that is kind of, we should measure that and we should track that, but what really makes us, deciding if the model is good to be deployed or not is afterwards on the adult set on an A-B testing in which we are really measuring the decision process integrated with a human or integrated with other things. So I'm not saying that we should not disregard measuring fairness before the machine learning model, but I think that our actions should be informed. But after we have in the model and we have in the predictions, we go back and we change and we tweak and we improve the representations, the sampling, and so on. I just missed the first one here, but nobody else kind of.
So regarding the first one, there's actually a clarification on the chat window, right? So the guys were asking.
So I should go to the answer?
So the clarifications was something like this. So could we analyze performance differences between groups which are well known and known to be prone to bias, like gender, right? And then look for similar patterns in other groups. This was regarding these bootstrapping idea.
Oh, no, I understand the point. So it's not about having a model that is biased and using it as a bootstrap for them all, is about groups, between groups. I think that makes totally sense for more for unsupervised kind of assessments rather than really for supervised, because unsupervised, if we have access to the group information, we can always measure the error rates. If we don't have access to the group information, then there is some recent work on trying to come up with proxy groups information that try to come up with specific characteristics in terms of the representation. For me, it's hard to see if we don't actually have access about the group, how can we move things? Of course, biases are similar across groups. We always have selection bias, sampling bias, label bias. And at the end of the day, is about, if we think about Bayesian formulation here, is about, our concept, our PY given X in the group Z, if it is the same across groups or not, and if the models are able to capture it. There's also a thing about concept and representation. If we have different class separation for different groups, then it becomes really, by that representation, it becomes really, really difficult to learn a model that will be able to, the model will be able to distinguish and learn a decision function on a given group for the both classes, but for the other, it will be really, really impossible. And then just transformations on the data will be able to separate the classes in a different way. But literature is very incipient in that respect yet.
Okay, so we had one last question. Okay, one of the students wanted to ask a question live, João Figueira.
Okay.
So maybe you can go ahead now. Okay, so while João sets up its microphone, I would just say that, other questions, people can decide to leave them on Slack as well. So Pedro, I would ask you to take a look, because we are going to be copying the questions that were posed here and the transcription for the answers to Slack, and people can also check them over there. Okay. So João, I don't know if you can turn on your microphone, maybe ask your question here. Oh, okay.
Well, apparently it was...
Apparently, so he has no questions now. So Pedro, thanks again. Okay, it was really interesting. To the rest of the attendees, I guess we'll see you in the afternoon lecture afterwards, okay? So thanks again, bye-bye.
No, thank you.
Thank you,
Pedro. Thank you.